Hi everyone, Peter here from Flow High Performance, and in this video, we will explore how to manipulate lifting technique to maximize muscle growth. Before getting into the details of lifting technique, we first need to understand the basic concept of what stimulates muscle growth. Essentially, muscle growth is stimulated by dynamic contraction against resistance. This stresses the muscle we are training, and we experience muscle growth as an adaptation to this stress. Exactly how to maximize the muscle growth response is an entire topic in itself, but the key point to understand here is that it is muscle stress which causes adaptation. And this stress is non-specific, which means we can stress the muscle with many different exercises, techniques, loads, rep ranges, and more. So what this means is technique should really be manipulated in a way that maximizes stress of the target muscle, not necessarily to maximize the load lifted. When discussing technique for hypertrophy training, there are two primary considerations: the hypertrophic stimulus and the fatigue induced. Basically, we want to maximize the stimulus to achieve the best muscle growth outcomes. However, we also want to minimize fatigue, which refers to a combination of psychological, physiological, and physical fatigue. Most notably, joint and connective tissue stress is the primary concern on the fatigue side of the equation for hypertrophy training. So for the rest of this video, we will be discussing how to not only lift in a way that provides the best hypertrophic stimulus, but also how to limit fatigue. Technique encompasses many different components. Therefore, we will discuss each factor individually and how we can best manipulate each variable to maximize the stimulus and minimize fatigue. So without further ado, let's cover how we can manipulate each component for hypertrophy training. The first and most fundamental factor to consider is anatomy and biomechanics. This refers to the anatomical structure of the target muscle, what movements it produces, and what movements the exercise requires. Put simply, before even considering other technique concepts, we need to make sure we are lifting in a way that requires the target muscle to contract against resistance. While this is primarily achieved via exercise selection, lifting technique does have an influence too. Essentially, rather than focusing on moving the load from point A to point B, we want to intentionally lift in a biomechanical path which places maximum tension on the muscle we are trying to train. For example, let's look at the anatomical structure of the trapezius muscle. As we can see, the entire trap muscle attaches onto the scapula, which is the shoulder blade bone. Therefore, if we want to target the middle region of the traps through rowing variations, we need to intentionally retract the scapula, which means to squeeze the shoulder blades together. If we simply focus on moving the load in whatever means necessary, we may not actually get much scapular retraction involved in the lift, and therefore the traps won't be maximally trained. This is one example, but this same concept applies to all other muscles in the body too. To maximally stress them, we need to look at their anatomical structure and intentionally lift in a way which requires dynamic contraction against resistance. So assuming we are implementing appropriate exercises and we are adequately recruiting the target muscle, the next technique consideration is range of motion. This refers to how much movement we get at the relevant joints and how much stretch under load the muscle is subject to. It is pretty clear that full range of motion training is almost always superior for muscle growth compared with partial range. This latest meta-analysis on the topic concluded that full range of motion training is superior for muscle growth compared with partial range on lower body exercises. These results could only be concluded for lower body muscles because most of the studies investigating range of motion happen to use lower body training. However, the same outcomes are likely to be true for upper body training too. Not only does full range of motion training result in superior muscle growth, it also likely minimizes fatigue, in particular joint stress. Lifting with a full range of motion usually requires lifters to use lighter loads compared with partial range training. This means that not only are we increasing muscle stress, we are also limiting joint loading. Using slightly lighter loads will limit overall joint and connective tissue stress, limiting our risk of injury over time. Therefore, in almost all cases, trainees should use full range of motion with all exercises. It should be noted that there are specific cases when partial range may be superior for certain exercises, but these are the vast minority of cases and we won't go into detail about these specific cases in this video. So, if we are lifting with a technique that trains the target muscle and performing full range of motion, we are probably getting most things right. However, to further maximize the hypertrophic response, the next layer to consider is strictness. Strictness is hard to define, but it generally refers to the ability to maintain technique without compensation. This means we only want movement at the relevant joints and avoid movement at all other joints which aren't directly involved with training that specific muscle. Ideally, we want to execute extremely strict technique in all exercises to ensure tension is focused on a specific muscle group without unnecessarily loading other muscles and joints. This is because we want to maximize tension on the target muscle and not take tension away and redistribute it to other muscles. Furthermore, lifting with less strict form allows us to lift heavier loads without necessarily increasing the hypertrophic stimulus. This will induce greater joint stress without providing any additional stimulus. In fact, it will likely result in a worse stimulus compared with a stricter technique. A classic example of this is during bicep curls. As we know, we want elbow flexion and maybe some slight shoulder flexion during curls. However, it is always tempting to swing the load towards the end of the set using hip and back movement. This definitely allows us to lift heavier weights, but it doesn't provide any additional stimulus to the biceps. If anything, it may take tension off the biceps at the bottom position. So in this case, the trainee is inhibiting the stimulus and increasing elbow joint stress. Therefore, trainees should always try to lift with strict technique, even if it means reducing the load slightly. This will maximize tension on the target muscle and limit joint stress. The next factor to consider for lifting technique is eccentric tempo. This refers to the speed or duration of the eccentric portion of the lift, which is when the muscle lengthens under load. We are specifically referring to eccentric tempo here because we have less control over concentric tempo. This is because regardless of what speed we perform the concentric tempo with, it will inevitably slow down as we near the point of failure. However, even under fatigue, we can still dictate the eccentric tempo since we are naturally stronger with these muscle actions. Generally, the research finds that lifting tempo doesn't have any significant impact on hypertrophy outcomes. The most recent meta-analysis on this topic found that neither slower or faster lifting tempos were significantly superior to the other. This is probably because when taking sets fairly close to failure, we will reach the same point of fatigue through dynamic muscle contraction, regardless of the exact repetition speed. However, we still want to ensure each repetition is somewhat controlled so that the muscle is actually required to perform the eccentric muscle action. If we use a very fast tempo, the muscle may not really be working, we may just be using gravity to lower the weight. So we still want to ensure that eccentric tempo is controlled, but the exact level of control probably doesn't impact the hypertrophic stimulus all that much. So, although the exact eccentric tempo doesn't really have an impact on muscle growth directly, it can impact the fatigue side of the equation. Using a faster tempo will allow us to lift heavier loads compared with a slower tempo, which will likely increase joint and connective tissue stress. Using a slower tempo, on the other hand, will allow us to equally stress the muscle while limiting joint stress and minimizing injury risk. Therefore, it is probably a good idea to preference a slightly slower eccentric tempo over a faster tempo. The next technique consideration for hypertrophy training is lifting composure. Once again, this is a difficult phenomenon to define, but it generally refers to the ability to maintain strict and effective technique for the entire duration of each set. As we know, as we near failure towards the end of a set, the tendency is to compensate by reducing strictness, cutting range of motion, or speeding up the tempo. Ideally, we don't want any compensation in technique for the entire set, especially for the last few reps. This is because doing so will take the tension off the target muscle and redistribute it to other muscles and joints. Like we mentioned at the start of the video, the goal for hypertrophy training is to maximally stress the target muscle, so losing composure is not what we want. A good way to understand this concept is that the last reps of a set should look exactly the same as the first rep, only slower. As an example, let's watch this video of me performing the latter half of a set of dumbbell curls. As we can see towards the end of the set, I try my best to maintain the exact same technique on every single rep despite the biceps being fatigued. The only difference that we should see is the concentric tempo slows down, which is a natural occurrence of fatigue. There is no compensation of strictness, range of motion, or eccentric control. Everything stays exactly the same. And the last primary technique consideration to maximize muscle growth is our intentional focus while lifting. Basically, an internal versus an external focus refers to what our intention is while lifting. An internal focus is where we focus on contracting a specific muscle, while an external focus refers to focusing on moving the load from point A to point B. This is a debatable topic for muscle growth, but in my experience, it is best to use an internal focus for hypertrophy training, while an external focus is more appropriate for strength training. An internal focus may be useful to help either directly increase muscle activation, or it can indirectly help us improve the other more important technique considerations. We do have one study looking directly at the effects of an internal versus an external focus while training on hypertrophy outcomes. This study involves subjects performing barbell curls and leg extensions for 8 weeks. One group trained with an internal focus, while the other group trained with an external focus. It was found that biceps hypertrophy was superior with the internal focus, although quad hypertrophy was similar between groups. These results are probably because the barbell curl is subject to a high degree of compensation, while the leg extension is almost impossible to cheat because you are locked in position. So in movements where there is potential to deviate from strict and effective technique, using an internal focus may be more relevant. This can help trainees to improve the other technique considerations and to keep tension on the target muscle. Furthermore, I don't see any downsides to using an internal focus, only potential benefits, and there are some potential issues with using an external focus. So for that reason, I would personally preference an internal focus with all exercises. And the last factor to consider for technique is individual variation. We all have slightly different anatomical structures that we may not even be aware of. There can be obvious differences in things like height, limb length, and bone structure, but there can also be hidden anatomical variations like muscle fiber orientation and muscle insertion points. Regardless of anatomy, the main principle should still be abided by, but the exact execution of each lift may look slightly different for different people. Therefore, trainees can use the general indicators of effective training to guide their technique development. We can use the mind-muscle connection during a set, the pump after a set, and muscle soreness the following day to gauge the effectiveness of technique and to guide future technique development. So to summarize this video, let's establish some practical recommendations. First, we should understand that for hypertrophy training, the goal is to maximize stress of a muscle group, not to lift the most amount of weight possible. Furthermore, we want to limit fatigue, in particular joint and connective tissue stress, while lifting. So essentially, the goal of lifting technique for muscle growth is to maximize the hypertrophic stimulus and minimize fatigue. There are a few different technique considerations we can manipulate to achieve this. First, we want to ensure our technique actually stresses the muscle we are trying to train from an anatomical and biomechanics perspective. Furthermore, to maximize muscle stress and minimize fatigue, we should use a full range of motion, strict form, and a somewhat controlled eccentric tempo. We also want to maintain this technique throughout the entire set by keeping our composure until the very last repetition. And lastly, it is probably a good idea to use an internal focus while lifting, meaning that we want to focus on contracting the target muscle to maximally stress it. It should also be noted that technique is subject to some slight individual variation, since our anatomy and physiology is unique for each person. Trainees can use the mind-muscle connection, muscle pump, and muscle soreness as methods to help guide their technique development over time. Thanks for watching, and hopefully you got something out of this video. Check out flowhighperformance.com for online coaching, training templates, ebooks, and more.